Hello, I'm Summer Teacher 7, also known as Mr. Barry, by my students. And this is lesson number 16 for the PC proficiency, also known as the computer literacy class. Now, this is the last video of this series. And what I'm going to be going over today are some of the skills that the students have requested that I go over again. After going over those skills, I'm then going to be covering cell phones and how to use them. Well, let's get started with the lesson. The very first skill that I want to go over is how to use one desktop but two windows simultaneously. Now, the students notice that a lot of times when I'm presenting work, that they will see my work on one side and maybe a video or other work on the other side. So I have two windows up in one desktop. So how do we do that? Well, if you look at the top, I have these tabs. These tabs can be separated and positioned where you want them to be. Over on the upper right-hand side, I have a minimize, which if I click it, it minimizes down here to my shelf, where I can then click it again and bring it back up. But there's another one here, and this is called the restore down or maximize, and then of course the X is the close. If I go down here to the restore down, the one in the middle, click it once, notice how it's going to take up less space. Now yours may not be situated just exactly like that. Maybe start right there. But what you do is you just drag it over to one half of your screen. Then you have other tabs. Now, if you don't have other tabs, you can always go new tab to find your work. But I already have my work open, and that's lesson number 16. So I click it. But now watch this. If I drag that down away from the top, notice how it separates itself into its own little window. And I can drag it from the top bar there to any place that I want. Let's say I want it right over here. And then notice the edges, they are movable. So I go right to that edge and I drag it out just like I'm resizing a picture. Perfect. Now on one side I have the video playing and on the other side I have the assignment. So if I wanted to go in and start the video, I just click it. And click it again.
Well, let's get started with the lesson. Our first topic of the day are file explorers. Now, these applications display.
Let me pause that. So, that's how you be playing the video and doing the lesson on the other window at the exact same time. Our next skill that we want to cover is working with images. So, let's go ahead and then start up a new tab. And what we're going to do is we're going to talk about finding images, and even finding the right size of images, how to save those images and give them a name, how to work with those images in Google Drive and Google Photos, and then also how to use the images within a Google Doc. So let's go to a new tab here. And I'm gonna type in Paris, Milan, and Mountain. And it brings up, we see some preview images there of Paris Milan Mountains. Next thing that we're going to do is let's go to images. And you notice that we have many images there, but they're all different sizes of images. So some of them are small images of the mountains between Paris and Milan, and others are very large images of the mountains between Paris and Milan. A very beautiful scene if you ever get to fly that way. What we're going to do is find just the large one. So notice I have different options up here. One of the options is called tools. So I click on tools, and then the very first one there is size. Click it, and notice I can say larger than 1024 by 768. If I click that one, the images refresh, and now I'm only left with the larger images, the ones that are larger, remember. And what we're going to do is go in, and let's choose one of these. So if I go in and click on one, now that image is separated from the others and I can right click it. When I right click, I get a context menu, and notice one of those options is save image as, which is right there. So I click on save image as, and it opens up to the save image as window. Now it gives it a name, but maybe a very long name of just numbers and letters as you see down here. What we want to do is rename that simply by typing the new name on the keyboard. So if I type in Paris, Milan, and then Mountain, one. Now it gives it a new name there. And then I click on save. And you see it over here in the lower right-hand corner, it saves it onto my drive. Okay, so I've saved the image. Wonderful. Now what can I do with the image? Well, maybe I want to upload that image into my Google Photos so I can use it on other computers. So I click on New tab. And whenever you click on New tab, I should see the app launcher over here. And let's find the Google Photos. Click on there. And then what we want to do is say upload. And we'll notice here that I can click on the image, click on open, and you'll see it's uploading the images. And once it's done, I click on the X, you'll refresh it, and it shows any that you've done today at the top there, like that. The next thing we're going to do is talk about how to use the images within Google Docs. So let's go ahead and create a new document. So we click here and we say New Google Doc. Go back to your images, and we have many images there. And let's say that I want to find one image here, perhaps this one. This is a lovely scene, so I click it. And then if I right click on that image, notice I have all these options. One of them is copy image, which is right there. I select copy image. I go back to my document. I right click in the middle of my document and I say paste. And there's my image within my document. So that's how we work with images. Our next skill that we're going to go over is using Google Photos with our cell phones. Now, if you have an Android phone or even one of the Apple phones, the iPhones, you can use an app called Google Photos. It's the same app that we use on our Chromebooks or on our Windows machines. We just want to make sure that we are logged into the same Google account. So if I open up mine and I go into apps, and there's Photos there, and I click it. Now, if you don't have that app yet, just go to the Play Store, type in Google Photos, download it, and it installs it. It's a free app. So once you've done that, any pictures that you take with your cell phone automatically get transported into your Google account, Google Photos specifically. So let's now work with some of the pictures here. Let's say that you've already taken a trip. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to type in August 18th, 2008. So I'm going to look for photos that I took with my cell phone on that particular day. And there they come up. So I took these pictures here way back when. And notice what we can do. I can, first of all, of course, I'm seeing them. But I can also go in and let's say I wanted to click on one. So let's click on one. And I have all these options up here. One of them is with the eye. If I click it, I can change the description. So let's just say many miles of road. So I say many miles of road, just a little description there. And if I click on the X, that goes away. But notice at the bottom, now it says that text at the bottom of my screen, at the bottom of the image there. Let's go back out and see what other things that we can do. Let's say that I want to go in and share all of these pictures. I could just click right here on this check mark and all of them become checked. Now, if I didn't want one of these images to be in there, I could take one out simply by clicking on the check. Now, it's all the images but that one. Then I click on the share icon, which is found here on the upper right-hand side of my screen. And then I can share it with either Facebook or all these other options. Or if I wanted just to share it with a particular person, I could just simply type in their email address. The next thing that we want to go over today is using our photos and finding the locations of where we took those pictures. Now, to enable this, you simply go to your cell phone's settings. go down to locations, and you can have that either turned on or turned off. If you have it on, whenever you take your pictures, it's going to record the location for you as well. So let's see, where is this information stored? I'm going to go and find some pictures I've taken, and let's go back to April 12th. And now these were pictures I took on April the 12th of this year. I will click on one picture, and notice again, we go back to these icons found in the upper right hand corner. I have the share, edit, zoom, and now this one here is a letter I in a little circle. If you click that, that's for information. And there you go. It shows the location of where that image was taken. Our next topic will be on smartphones. Now, these steps are focused on Android phones. However, if you have an Apple phone, you can still follow along and use the same steps. So the first term that we're going to be covering is Wi-Fi. Particularly, what is Wi-Fi? Many of us have an internet connection at home with a Wi-Fi signal. And Wi-Fi is a technology that uses radio waves to provide a network connection. An area with a Wi-Fi signal is called a Wi-Fi hotspot. Many restaurants, libraries, and even gas stations now provide Wi-Fi hotspots so that their customers can connect to the internet. Wi-Fi hotspots are normally only about as large as the building that they are housed in. So you must be near the source of the Wi-Fi in order to connect to it. What devices can connect to Wi-Fi? Well, the list of Wi-Fi ready devices is growing every day, but here is the list of the most commonly used devices. Number one would be laptops and Chromebooks. And we would use those to connect to the internet, looking up recipes, checking our email, watching videos, listening to music, creating new documents, etc. And our smartphones, we do the exact same thing now. Next would be Wi-Fi enabled desktop PCs. Again, same thing. And now we also have Wi-Fi enabled smartwatches. Other devices that can connect to Wi-Fi are Wi-Fi cameras, Wi-Fi refrigerators, Wi-Fi thermostats, Wi-Fi radios, Wi-Fi water heaters, Wi-Fi security systems, Wi-Fi printers, car stereos, and the list goes on and on and on. The point to all this is that when you have a Wi-Fi enabled device, that device can connect to the internet and download its own updates or give an access point to the users to the internet where they can find more resources such as music, email, videos, recipes, and so on. And I even found some Wi-Fi enabled refrigerators. Here's one from Samsung. It actually has a screen on it. And here's another refrigerator from Samsung. It has a very large screen on it, as you can see there in the picture. Next, working with smartphones and tablets. The technology used in smartphones has changed greatly in the past few years, with simpler, more ergonomically designed features. First off, the buttons. Most cell phones and tablets today have at least two main buttons. There's a small power button and the longer volume control button, as you can see here. The first button here is the power button. It's normally found on the right-hand side of the device, but a few designs have it on the top or even on the left-hand side. The volume control button is normally always longer than the power button and is found on the left-hand side of most devices that I've seen. The home button is next. The home button is found at the lower portion of the face of your Android device. It may be a physical button or a button that appears right on the screen. It is designed to open the home screen where the user may find icons to make calls, take photos, or even open a favorite app. And here's a few examples of home buttons that I found. The very first one is a home button on a Samsung phone or device. The next one is the home button on an Amazon Fire. Next is the Motorola Ease home phone or home button. And then we also have a home button found on the generic smartphone. Other important buttons include the back button and the option buttons. And this would allow you to go back to previously viewed pages or different apps that you were working on previously. And then the option, of course, opens up more options for whatever place that you're working with. Turning on your smartphones and tablets from standby. Turning on these devices is very easy. Just tap or press the power button and then swipe on the screen with your finger. The term standby usually refers to the device not being completely off or completely on. It is in standby, waiting to ring when you receive a call, just like your home phones of yesteryear. Here are a few examples of login screens that I found. The first one, of course, is the Samsung device. Next is the Android Amazon Fire. Then we have the Motorola E. And the last one is just a generic Android smartphone. And now please notice that all of the login screens have many similar characteristics. They all have some method of unlocking the device. The Samsung, it was swiping. For the Amazon Fire, it was perhaps pressing and then unlocking with the lock. For the Motorola E, it was hold and swipe. And then for the generic Android, it was a long press on the device that you want to go onto or the app that you want to open. They have many of the same methods too for turning on the camera app. So they usually have a small icon of a camera right there in the lock screen or the login screen that you can press and hold and then swipe to the center. Next, how to turn off your Android phone. To power down your Android device, press and hold the power button for a few seconds and then tap the option that reads power off right on the screen. So you would see this pressing the power button and then a message comes up that says power off, and that's the option that you choose. Please note that I rarely actually turn off any of my smartphones. Next, working with the home screen. The home screen is the one screen on your device that loads after you log in and shows you any links to any of the features. So on this one, you notice it would have the time and the most commonly used apps. Let's now look at more details at the bottom of this screen. So we have icons for the phone, the camera, the apps icon, the message or messenger, and then the browse the internet. So let's look at the frequently used apps found on most phones. You may have one called Google Photos, Camera, the Play Store, where you can find more apps, the apps icon, where you can find more apps on your device, Google Chrome to browse the internet, and then you have a notification bar, which is sometimes called the status bar. In fact, it's called both because the notification bar resides on the left-hand portion of that area and the status is over on the right. Then we also have the phone to make phone calls with. Now, to use the notification bar. This bar normally shows up at the top of the Android screen. It is divided into two main areas: the notification area on the left and the status area on the right. It is easy to find because it resides on the top of the home screen of most smartphones and at the bottom of most tablets. The most common notification area buttons or icons. Apps and messages services can drop you a note on the left-hand side of the notification area. This is the place to look if you have any new emails, missed calls, Facebook posts, or any weather updates, etc. The following icons indicate that you've received a notification. So if you see one with an F, that's a Facebook post. Here's the dialogue window here, or a dialogue bubble, and that means that you've been invited to a hangout. And you say, well, what's a hangout? It's just like Skype. It is a video call, but you can do hangouts with your camera turned off so that you're just doing a voice call. The nice thing about it is it's free. Here, if you see this icon, it means missed call. This icon with a check mark means that an application has been updated. An icon with an arrow pointing down with a line means that a file such as a song, perhaps a video or something else of terms of a file has been downloaded. And here we see John Denver Sunshine, the song, has been downloaded and it has been completed. And if you see one with a cross in the middle of a white square, normally that means the device health alerts, to draw your attention to a health alert. Next, if you have the Google Drive icon emblem there, or icon, this means that someone has shared something with you. It could be a photo or a message. Next, you have the G with a plus. That means a new Google Plus notification. Next, you have a dialogue bubble with a check in middle with an arrow at the end. This means that you've missed a call. Next is a triangle with a red or a flashing exclamation mark in the middle. This is usually an amber alert, and that would have a city name and a description of the vehicle or the missing person on there as well. Next is a green check. If you have a Freedom Pop phone, it'll set up a phone number for you. And next we have an icon with an arrow coming down, simply meaning that the system update has been completed there. Other notification icons. You have one with an M on it, means new mail or new Gmail. If you have an icon there that looks kind of like a trident, that means that you're connected with a USB device or USB cable. Next is if you have the icon of a phone, that means your call is in progress. You're actively talking on the phone there. Next, if you see the two circles with the line at the bottom, that is a new voicemail. Next is a cloud with an arrow coming up through it. That means that you have sync to Google Drive has been completed. To see the details of any of the notifications there on the notification bar, just swipe it down to reveal more information. Next, how to use the notification bar continued there. And we're going to look at the most commonly used status area icons. The status icons indicate the status of the smartphone. For example, it shows the time, the phone battery's strength, the cellular signal strength, the Wi-Fi signal strength, etc. And here's the list that we have here. So notice if you see this icon, you're connected to a GPRS mobile network, or the GPRS network is in use. Here you're connected to the Edge mobile network. And here if it's in green, the Edge network is in use. If you're using 3G or 4G, you'll usually have that. And the arrows, if they're in green, that means it's in use. Next are these bars. And the more bars are lit up, the stronger this signal strength. If you're connected to Wi-Fi, you'll have one that looks like a fan. And you can see it here. Next, your Bluetooth is on. And if you're connected to a Bluetooth device, such as a Bluetooth keyboard or a Bluetooth mouse that you can find at Walmart or at Big Lots, then it'll show this icon here. And that means you can actually use your keyboard on your smartphone to type up documents or send out messages, because many times people have trouble with those small screens. Next, if you put your phone into airplane mode, you'll usually see an icon in an airplane there, or you may see this icon shown here. Next, if you have turned on your alarm so that it goes off to wake you up in the morning, or if you're taking a nap, you usually would have a clock on there with that icons there. Next, if your smartphone is on, you may have this icon. If your roaming is turned on, you may have this with this green area here. And if you're out in the middle of nowhere and you have no signal whatsoever, all the bars usually are black and usually there is a check on them as well. Next, if for some reason you've taken out the SIM card, you'll see no SIM card installed icon, which is usually a picture of the SIM card with an exclamation mark on it. And you have a vibration mode, and then the ringer is silenced. Those two are really important. Let's say that you're in the library, or perhaps you're in class, and you don't want it to ring while you're in class. For most of the new phones, you notice that you have volume control. You press that all the way down, and then you press it again. And what that does is that turns on vibrate mode. And so when you get a call, it might vibrate. If you, on other phones, you can go down arrow key and then click it once and then click it again. And that also does the same thing, depending on really how old your phone is and who made the phone. Other icons, we have ringer is silenced. And then you can also have the phone microphone is muted. And here's the icons for the battery, whether it's very low or fully charged or charging. And then we also have GPS is on. And if you're receiving location data from GPS, you usually have the same icon, but with a dot in the middle. Now GPS on phones, you can turn that on and off by going into the settings. So you find your settings, and then you go in there and there's an icon that actually has the label settings. Once you click on the settings, it goes in and it shows options for GPS and other things about your location. If you leave everything on, some people say, well, that uses a little bit of battery there, but I like leaving mine on because that way I can find my phone if I ever lose it. Now you can receive more details from the status area by simply pulling down the area with your finger. A drop-down curtain will appear with the details. To see even more details on any of the notification or status icons, just tap them with the tip of your finger, as you see me doing in this drawing that I made. To dismiss all notifications, all you gotta do is tap the clear button. On newer Android phones, you can access the notification area from the lock screen now. Furthermore, you can dismiss each notification one by one simply by swiping it to the left or to the right on your screen. Next, how to place a call with your smartphone. Now you may say, Mr. Perry, that's rather basic. Well, we're going over this with many people who are brand new to their cell phones, and so they're watching it for this reason, because they want to make a call. Now, first off, of course, log in and turn on your phone. This photo shows me holding a cell phone with my right hand, and then I'm pressing the power on button with my right thumb and sliding up with my left finger's index finger. So I'm holding it like this and I swipe up, and that's how you turn mine on and you type in the code, your security code to get in. Next, you click on the icon that looks like a phone. You may now place a call by either tapping the numbers and saying out the name of the person that you wish to call, or by tapping on contacts and then finding the person that you wish to call, as you see me doing there in these photos. Next, how to set up Wi-Fi on your Wi-Fi enabled device. The majority of Wi-Fi enabled devices are running some form of Android OS. So these steps will work with most cell phones, tablets, car stereos, etc.? First, find the settings icon. This is not the Google settings icon, remember, but the settings icon that looks like what I have shown here on the screen. You do this by looking through the apps, which have been installed on the Android device. This is normally done by tapping the apps icon and then swiping through all the pages until you find the settings icon. Once you have located the settings icon, tap it and it will open up settings for you. The settings window should look just like we see here. The first one is the Samsung device, and that's what it would look like. So notice we have shortcuts to Wi-Fi and other areas that we have here. And up towards the top, we have shortcuts to My Device, Accounts, and even more. And don't be afraid to look through there and get familiarized with all the settings of your phone. Next, we see the Amazon Fire device. And then we see a Motorola E device. And then we see the settings for the generic Android. Next, once the setting windows is open and you want to set up with Wi-Fi, click on the Wi-Fi option. The Wi-Fi option window should load. This window will show any SSID that is in range. Now remember, an SSID is the name of a wireless network. So here we see some wireless networks in the area when I turned on these phones. Tap the SSID that corresponds to the home network that you want to connect to. If you're not sure, it is normally the SSID with the strongest signal. So in this case, I clicked on the Berry D-Link. If you have the security turned on within your wireless router, then you will be asked to key in the Wi-Fi password. And it looks like this on these different screens. Simply key in, the numbers go there. If you don't know what that is, look at the bottom or next to your Wi-Fi router and it will say the passphrase or the password, and then it'll give that to you. Normally it's a series of letters and numbers and it's pretty long, normally 10 or more characters long. Type that in and then click on connect. If you have keyed in the correct password, then you should now be connected to the Wi-Fi hotspot in your area, and you should have the internet. Tap the home button to return to the home screen of your device. Now, to use your smartphone or tablet as a camera. The camera technology within newer cell phones has surpassed that used in low-cost digital cameras, and the photos they take are automatically uploaded to your Google Photos as long as you have installed the Google Photos app and have logged into your Google account from that phone. You can also easily share any photo or group of photos by using the Google Photo app share tool, seen there that I took a picture of for you. Press the power button to see the login screen. Now you have different options. Option one is tap or swipe up the camera icon to the center of the screen. The camera app should load. Option two is to tap and hold the camera icon until the camera app loads. Now the camera app should load as seen here. Notice there may be many options within there. Each camera manufacturer is a little bit different on the options that you're given. There are many options for taking the best shots. Most smartphones come with two cameras. This tool switches between the two cameras for you, either the camera that faces you or the camera that faces out from you. You may have a flash on your camera. You can turn that on, off, or even turn it to auto. And then of course you have that one is the shutter release. Now on some phones you don't have a shutter release icon. Instead you simply tap in the middle of the photo and that takes the picture. With this icon here, you have more options. This is the shooting mode tool. It holds many options such as a single shot, burst or best shot, best face, sound and shot, face detection, and panorama, which allow you to take photos like a pro. I normally just leave it all set to automatic, so the camera just naturally takes the best shots for me. Next is the wand with the sparkles coming out of it. The effects tool holds many options to change the lighting effects placed within your shots. I normally leave this tool off. Next, it looks like a little gear. The settings tool holds many options such as burst shot, GPS tag, self-portrait mode, flash options, and more shooting modes. Once you have selected the options that you wish, you can leave it all these options alone if you want. Aim at your target and then press the shutter release and it'll take a picture for you as you see I just done. Once you press the shutter release, the camera takes the photo and stores it within your Google Photos gallery. If you have installed the Google Photos app and logged into your Google account, then the photos also go into your Google Photos gallery right online for you. Next topic, steps for installing Google Photos on your smartphone or tablet. Google Photos is a great app that ties the photos you take with an easy to use gallery, a way to share your photos with others via Facebook, Google Plus, and other social media apps, and the ability to search through all of your photos by face, setting, object, date, or even location. To install Google Photos, find the app called the Play Store and then open it by tapping it. The Play Store should open as seen here. Tap inside the long white text box and then key in Google Photos, as you see me doing here. Once you have tapped in the words Google Photos and tap on the search key once, the window will change to one that is very similar to the one shown here. Tap on the Google Photos app to open it. In the next window, tap the small green install button as seen here. The Google Photos app will install in a few minutes. Once it is installed, you may open it by tapping on the Google Photos app found right on your smartphone, as seen here. Once the Google Photo app loads, it will show a window similar to this one here. And I also have seen an option where it shows a window that comes up and says, "Who are you?" And you can key in your email address and your Google password, and then that way it links your phone with your Google Photos online. How to share a photo using Google Photos. Tap on the photo or photos that you wish to share. The photo will fill the screen as seen here. Tap on the share icon as seen here. Once you have tapped the share icon, the window will change to the one shown here, showing you many options from which you can share with. If you tap on the Facebook icon, you then follow the on-screen instructions to finish sharing that photo with your Facebook friends. Everything works perfectly as long as you have logged into your Google and Facebook accounts on that particular smartphone. Next topic, Freedom Pop. Freedom Pop is a wireless internet and mobile phone service provider based in Los Angeles, California. They carry a wide range of Android and Apple smartphones. They have these smartphones on sale at a fraction of the price of what other carriers charge. These sales can be found by using Groupon.com's website, and just do a search for Freedom Pop once you're at the Groupon.com website to find those sales. There are no contracts, and services can be canceled at any time. When you purchase a smartphone, you are also given a Freedom Pop account, which you can use to check your services and billing. There are many services and plans ranging from free to around $30 a month. Well, that was our lesson about using our smartphones and plus all those other topics that we covered. For those who are watching on YouTube, please rate, comment, and subscribe to my channel if you haven't done so already. And also, please notice I have a Patreon page. If you want to help support me in creating videos, please visit there, and you may make a small donation, which would be greatly appreciated. Thank you very much, and have a good day. Bye-bye.